and Michael Backes on efficient cryptographic password hardening services from partially oblivious commitments. So this talk is going to have three main sections. In section one, I'm going to recall password hardening services and how they can be useful to protect stolen password hashes from offline brute force attacks. In the second part, I'll present our first contribution, which is a proof that a recent cryptographic construction of such a service cannot be built from simple cryptographic assumptions, but inherently relies on strong interactive assumptions. And in the last part of the talk, I'll outline our new construction, which goes for a slightly different notion of security, but can be realized from simple assumptions instead. So let's first recap what password hardening services are and why we care about them. So in a traditional password-based authentication mechanism, users submit their passwords to a database which computes a hash on the password and compares it to the password hash stored in the database from when the user first set up their account. So usually the hashes are stored and computed on the same machine here. The idea for a crypto service architecture is that we hash the passwords together with a very large random secret, and we distribute that that secret to a remote machine. And the idea here is that introducing this interaction makes it more difficult for an attacker who has access to the password database to gain any useful information from that. So now the hashes only can be computed interactively, and this means that while previously the attacker could compute a table of common password hashes and compare it to his stolen password database, now the attacker only has that database but doesn't know the secret, and thus has a much harder time computing this table. There are several security considerations you have to make, and I just want to highlight two of them here. So first, you might not want to leak the passwords to this remote machine, since if you imagine it's not under your control, it's literally run as a service for multiple independent clients. It's easy to see that we don't want this service to know our real passwords. And secondly, if this concept really works and offline brute force attacks can be prevented this way, an attacker will likely try to use the service itself to run an online brute force attack, and we want to be able to detect malicious requests, like thousands of queries for the same username in a second or something like that. And the recent cryptographic solution to this problem was given at last year's Usenix conference by Everspore, Chatterjee, Scott, Schulz, and Ristenpart. And it's based on a new cryptographic primitive called partially oblivious PRFs, which allows a client to compute a pseudo-random function under a key held by a service, such that the client doesn't learn the key, and the service learns part of the client's input, but not all of it. The resulting instantiation as a password hardening service is called Pythia, and it has all those nice properties we talked about, and the key property among them being offline, being one more unpredictability, which is their way of formalizing offline brute force attack prevention. And this is also the starting point of our research, namely the proof of security given here. They show that Pythia achieves one more unpredictability under the one more bilinear computational Diffie-Hellman assumption. And this is a new assumption from a family of strong interactive assumptions in bilinear, in groups with bilinear pairings. And for us, a natural question was, can we prove this scheme secure under a simpler assumption, in the best case, a non-interactive assumption? And as we're going to see, that's not possible, But let me first show you what this this property actually is all about. So as I said before, in order to prevent offline brute force attacks, one way to do that is to prevent an attacker from building a useful hash dictionary. And in the Usenix paper, this is formalized as a game between an attacker and the honest crypto service. And the attacker can make an arbitrary number n of requests to the service for input-output pairs. And in the end, he's supposed to come up with a list of valid input-output pairs for this function computed by the service. And the attacker is successful in this game if he can produce more valid pairs than could have been obtained through the interactions with the service. So coming back to the, coming back to the intuition behind this, if the attacker can produce more valid pairs, or can't produce more valid pairs than through the interactions with the service, this means that if the attacker wants to build a lookup table, he'd have to interact with the service, and if the service can then detect malicious requests, we can probably shut down his attempt at building such a dictionary. Okay, now how can we show that Pythia cannot achieve this property from a non-interactive assumption, like for example DDH assumption or something like that? Assume we have an attacker A against the one-more unpredictability of Pythia and some black box reduction R to any non-interactive problem. The reduction gets as input a problem instance X and is supposed to output a solution Y to this problem with the help of the adversary who's available as a black box. Now, say after giving the scheme's public information to the adversary makes a query for input M and the reduction truthfully answers with the corresponding output F of M. And that's all very good, but I didn't tell you before, except maybe in the title of the slide, that our adversary is in fact a magic unbounded adversary with unbounded computational power. So the adversary can actually perform an exhaustive search on the key space and derive the secret key from the scheme's public key. And now the adversary can draw a random input for himself and compute the function on his own. And submitting both these pairs he has computed should allow the reduction to compute a solution Y to the problem. If the reduction is correct, this solution will be valid with high probability. This thought experiment doesn't, of course, violate the hardness assumption of the problem, since our adversary is magic and unbounded. But if we can somehow show that the view in the interaction with the magic adversary of the reduction can be simulated in an efficient way, this means that the reduction, together with our efficient simulation of the magic adversary, can now efficiently solve this problem, which we had assumed to be hard. And for this, to this end, we construct a so-called meta reduction, which is exactly that. We simulate this magic adversary efficiently. And it also takes as input a problem instance X and forwards that to the reduction, which generates the scheme public parameters and forwards them to our simulated adversary. And now we chose choose a random input M and let the reduction compute the corresponding output. And now comes the trick in our proof. We rewind the execution of the reduction to the point before we made our query. And now we can make another query for a different input M prime and get another input-output pair. And since we now have two valid input-output pairs, and they were in fact computed by the reduction, we can submit those to the reduction, and the reduction will output a solution to our problem. Great. Now, because of the blindness property of Pythia, these two interactions are in fact indistinguishable for the reduction. So the reduction can't tell, am I running with this magic adversary, or am I being rewound by the meta reduction? So essentially, this reduction means that, or this meta reduction means that if our hardness assumption is reasonable, there cannot be such a black box reduction from the one more unpredictability of Pythia to any non-interactive assumption, since then the problem wouldn't be hard in the first place. Okay, now how can we navigate around this impossibility result? I'll show you how we can slightly reframe this problem and build a new construction which is secure from simple assumptions. And to this end, let's take a step back and look at this password authentication mechanism again. And if you look closely, you can make out two phases. In the first phase, the user creates their account. We call this the enrollment phase. And they submit their username and password. There's an interaction with the hashing service. And in the end, the database client stores some kind of artifact, which we call an enrollment record, together with the username for subsequent logins. In the second phase, when a user returns to their account and wants to log in, they again submit their username and some password prime, and after the interaction with the hashing service, the database client reaches a decision whether or not password prime is valid for that username. So this is what we call the validation phase. If we abstract this into cryptographic protocols, we arrive at three protocols. The first one is just a setup phase where the client and the service agree on some keys. In the second phase, the enrollment phase, the client has as input username T and password M, and there's a capital T input here that's superfluous, which you should ignore, because this capital T is the enrollment record, which is only generated in this phase. And in the third phase, the validation phase, given such an enrollment record for any username and password combination and another combination of username and password, we want to reach a decision, accept or reject, whether that username and password are valid for the enrollment record. And there are some security properties, which I'm going to highlight now. Similar to Pythia, we require that the service doesn't learn M in any of the interactions with the client. So the password stays hidden from the service, but the input, the username, should be revealed to detect any malicious requests. Also, we want to make sure we have a clear understanding of which username and password combinations are the correct one and allow validation. And of course, we also want to prevent attacks against our offline attacks against our enrollment records. And I'm going to describe these three properties in more detail now. So we formalized the requirement that the service shouldn't learn the password in a property we call hiding, and it's described in a two-stage game where in the first stage an adversary can completely determine the output of the setup phase and also supplies a challenge username with two challenge passwords and a challenge record. And in the second phase we flip a coin and let an honest client interact with the adversary during enrollment and validation queries, where we use one of the challenge passwords and the other information supply, given by the first stage adversary. And in the end, the adversary outputs a bit B prime, and we say the scheme is hiding if the adversary has at most negligible chance of guessing the correct or determining the correct password which was used in these interactions. Okay, and the second property is called binding, and it's necessary since we made the validation process into an abstract process where we are really just interested in the decision reached at the end and have to define which usernames and passwords are relevant here. So we define this property where an adversary takes the role of a client and can make arbitrary enrollment and validation queries to an honest service. And eventually the adversary outputs two different username and password combinations and an enrollment record. And we say this adversary is successful if both username and password combinations succeed in the validation phase. So, lastly, our notion of offline attack prevention is called obliviousness, and it's a game in three stages, where in the first stage, an adversary can make arbitrary enrollment and validation queries to an honest service and outputs challenge username and two challenge passwords and some states for the next stage adversary. And then in an intermediate second stage, we perform an honest enrollment of one of these challenge passwords, and the adversary in the next stage is now supposed to decide which password is contained in this enrollment record. And since we since the adversary has to decide which of these passwords is contained and he supplied them himself, he's now not allowed to do any validation queries anymore, since that would trivially reveal that information. And we say the scheme is oblivious if the adversary has at most negligible chance of finding out which password is contained in that record. Okay, since this obliviousness is quite a different notion from one more unpredictability, let's briefly discuss how they relate to each other and recall that one more unpredictability means that an attacker cannot compute a hash dictionary without interaction with the honest service. And by contrast, in this hashing scenario, obliviousness means that given any number of known hash input-output pairs, hashes where the input is inputs are known can still not be distinguished. And in general, it means that an attacker cannot verify a guess at enrollment record content. And together with the binding mechanism, this can give us brute force offline attack protection for authentication mechanisms beyond simple equality checks. Okay, and with this formalization out of the way, let's look at a concrete instance of our primitive. We are working in a group G of order Q with a generator small g, where we assume the DDH problem is hard. And in the enrollment phase, the client gets his input username T and password M. And first thing is the client draws a random exponent to blind the password and sends over the username and the blinded password to the service. The service now computes an enrollment record, which is this triple highlighted here, where the first part is just a random group element. The second part of the triple is that group element raised to a value derived from the username, and the last part is the second part taken to the power of the secret key and multiplied by the blinded password. We also generate a proof that this record was generated correctly, namely that we used the correct secret key corresponding to the public key. And if this proof verifies, the client stores an unblinded version of this record. Validation follows a very similar pattern. The client again receives username and password and sends over that username and password together, this time with a part of the old enrollment record for that username. And the service again computes an enrollment record, this time for the new password. And now we generate two proofs, which somehow have to make sure that the record contains essentially the same password that is in the old record. So the first proof just says we're using the correct value derived from the username, and the second record validates if the password is correct, is the same one as in the old record. And if both proofs verify, we accept, else we reject. Let's briefly sketch the intuition behind our security proofs. For the hiding property, observe that the service only ever sees this blinded version of the password, and in fact the random exponentiation hides the password unconditionally, so our scheme is indeed hiding. The binding property, which is sort of this collision resistance in the username and password property, follows from first the pseudo randomness of this value derived from the username, and the soundness of the proof system, which says that only one password will be valid and makes the proof verify. And the proof for obliviousness is a bit more involved and consists of a series of game hops where we first replace the PRF by a truly random function. Then we simulate all the zero knowledge proofs, and in the end we can show that the two challenge password records are indistinguishable given the DDH assumption. Okay, we also implemented this as a prototype in Python using the charm toolkit and ran it on a standard web server, and our results are quite promising. So over an internet connection, we have on average 64.7 milliseconds for an enrollment query and a bit more than that for a validation query. In both cases, that's a little bit less than the Pythia prototype, which we ran for comparison, and pretty much translates to the local network setting where the service and the database are run in the same data center. And I guess our advantage here comes from the fact that we can avoid pairings, even though there's more going on in the scheme. But yeah, Pythia relies centrally on cryptographic pairing, so these are still very expensive. In terms of storage scalability, we come in at about 444 bytes per enrollment, which suggests about 8.5 gigabytes of database storage for 20 million users, so that's nice as well. And with that, I'd like to conclude my talk. And I have shown you that Pythia inherently relies on strong cryptographic assumptions and how we can build a scheme that relies on simpler assumptions by going for a slightly different security notion. And an open question I'd like to leave you with is whether our security notion is actually as good as you can get from simple assumptions, because the notion of one more unpredictability and obliviousness seem quite incomparable to us, and so it's not clear whether we can actually do better from simple assumptions. And with that, I'd like to conclude my talk and answer any questions. Thanks.